Hello students, how are you doing? This is Ranjana ma'am and it's your channel that you are watching, and I have got quite a few requests regarding a very difficult chapter, the blue bead. So without wasting any more time, I will start it. But at the same time, remember the blue bead will need two videos because it's not so lengthy, but you need to understand each and every word, or rather, because there are two parts, especially the encounter and how Sibia fights the crocodile. So they are important, and in the beginning, that description of that mugger crocodile and all that. So I will do it in two parts. Please bear with me. The blue bead. So first, I always tell, read the box. Okay. The blue in blue bead, Norah, Burke paints a vivid graphic picture rich in detail of an exciting jungle adventure. An encounter between Sibia. Sibia is the main protagonist, a 12-year-old girl, and a crocodile, as an everyday event. Mane, for us, when we read it, we find, oh my god, what a dangerous encounter. But to Sibia, she's so casual about it. Oh, you all must be, if you have not read, you all must be wondering why, what is ma'am talking about. So Burke makes skillful use of suspense and detailed visual images that make the story come alive for the reader. The story ends on a note of dramatic irony when Sibia exclaims, "Something did. I found the blue bead for my necklace. Look." So to her, the fight with the crocodile and the killing of the crocodile and the saving of the Gujjar woman is not so important as her having found the blue bead. So, this is really the irony here. We would have been gloating on, you know, how I killed a crocodile, boasting and all that. No, no, no. For her, it is nothing. It's very as if commonplace. But just see the crocodile and you will realize, no, it was not a very casual thing. This crocodile, such a wicked creature, such a huge, august creature. So this is the villain of the story, okay? And Sibia is the heroine. She is a child woman. Now you will come to know why child woman. So let's continue. By the way, before I start, I hope you have subscribed to my channel. And if you have not up till now, please do. And press the like button. And for that, you have to watch the video till the end. And then, don't give me a dislike if you dislike it. Anyway, let's continue without wasting any more time. The blue bead. From deep water came the crocodile. What a nice way to begin a story. It is as if you can see it in your minds. A crocodile coming from the deep waters. Out of the black water, curved with whirlpools, and into the frill of gold shallows by the stepping stones. So, right in the beginning, the reader catches our attention. With the crocodile coming straight and from where? He was twice the length of a tall man. So tall man, let's imagine he should be 6 feet at least. And twice means 6 × 2 = 12. My God, what a huge one. And inside him, among the stones which he had swallowed to aid digestion, rolled a silver bracelet. So this is a bit of humor. Suppose we swallow those tablets now for our digestion, like Rantac, Zintac, and all these Union Zyme, whatever. So after having a heavy dinner, we go for it. And so the crocodile also has done the same. He has swallowed not some tablets, he has swallowed some stones, and along there is also a silver bracelet which he has swallowed. Maybe he must have eaten up some rich person, and the person has disappeared in his teeth only, the bones and all, but the silver bracelet is still there. Jokes apart, timber was being floated down the great Indian river from forests further up, and there were sleepers lying stuck around the stones until someone came to dislodge them and send them on their way, or until floods lifted them and jostled them along. Actually, this is the process in India and in many other places also, where there are rivers. So, logs of wood, instead of taking the land route, many times now they would let these, they would make them float, and slowly from the upstream they would go to the lower banks, and then there would be people who will haul them in the lower banks, and or if not, they get stuck in one bank and it is supposed to be needed somewhere further lower, then they will push it. And sometimes it may get stuck. Then some people will go and again push it and send them in their destination. So this is a natural process of transporting wood through water. The crocodile had no need to hide himself. Yeah, that's true. It's such a ferocious creature. It is not afraid of anyone. Same for that lion or the tiger or the elephant. They don't need to be silent. He came to rest in the glassy shallows among logs and balanced there on tiptoe on the rippled sand with only his raised eyes out of the water and raised nostrils, breathing the clean sunny air. So the crocodile came to rest close to the shore. Around him, broad sparkling water traveled between cliffs and grass and forested hills. So Norah Burke, if you have read other stories also, I don't think you might have read. But in the earlier syllabus also, there was one story I used to teach, Journey by Night. So she is very fond of details, the visual imagery, there are lots. So you can as if see it in your own mind, how the crocodile is and the surroundings of the crocodile. A jungle track came out of scrub, each side and down to the sun-whitened stepping stones on which a little flycatcher was flirting and trilling along. A little flycatcher, an insect, dancing from one place to the other. The mugger crocodile, blackish brown above, a type of Indian crocodile. I think like in Hindi we say na mugger much. So that is a Hindi name for the crocodile. And another is ghadiyal. So they are the two types. So here I think that is why she has written mugger crocodile. Blackish brown above and yellowy white under lay motionless. So the upper portion of the crocodile, just see, is blackish brown, and the bottom portion, the stomach portion, is yellow white, lay motionless, able to wait forever, and it is waiting for what? For food to come. This antediluvian saurian, this prehistoric juggernaut, ferocious and formidable, so many adjectives to describe, a vast force in water, propelled by the unimaginable and irresistible power of the huge deep. Yeah, two things are very powerful for the crocodile. One, the set of teeth, and the other, the tail. They are both very powerful and they are the greatest assets of a crocodile. Lapped by ripples, a throb in his throat, his mouth running almost the whole length of his head, was closed and fixed in that evil bony smile. I have never heard a crocodile smile, never seen also, but well, I haven't seen many crocodiles, but if you all have seen, just try to think if you have seen it smile. And where the yellow underside came up to it, it was tinged with green, most probably because of the moss by the riverside. From the day perhaps 100 years ago, so the author is not sure, but she guesses that maybe the crocodile is 100 years ago, when the sun had hatched him in a sandbank. So poor crocodile has no mother to hatch it. It is being hatched by the sun. The mother has laid the egg and gone into the water. And then the sun hatches the crocodile. And he had broken his shell and got his head out and looked around, ready to snap at anything before he was even fully hatched. Before he had fully come out of his shell only, he is ferocious, he is ready to snap at anything. Oh, the fighter right from the beginning. From that day, when he had at once made for the water, ready to fend for himself immediately, he had lived by his brainless craft and ferocity. So, the moment it was fully hatched, what did the crocodile do? It ran into the waters. And from that time, it was small and it could have been a victim or a prey to those big, big birds of prey or to the big fish. But no, it knew how to save itself and escape these creatures. Just see, escaping the birds of prey, the hawk, the kite, the vultures, ready to prey on a small crocodile. And the great carnivorous fishes that eat baby crocodiles, he had prospered, catching all the food he needed and storing it till putrid in holes in the bank. Actually, it would store the food till they rotted, became rotted. Tepid water to live in and plenty of rotted fruit, food grew him to his. So how did he become so strong? Lots of tepid water. I told you they aid in digestion. And rotten food makes him so strong and so powerful. Now nothing could pierce the inch thick armored hide. Yeah, once it grows to its full length, it has become so powerful. The hide has become so powerful. It is like bulletproof. You cannot pierce anything through it. Not even the rifle bullets which would bounce off. Only the eyes and the soft underarms offered a place. These are the two vulnerable places where it could be attacked with some effect. The eyes portion and the underarm. He lived well in the river, sunning himself sometimes with other crocodiles, muggers, as well as the long-snouted fish-eating gharials. I told you two types, na? On warm rocks and sandbanks where the sun dried the clay on them quite white, and where they could plop off into the water in a moment. So they are clever. And the moment they feel there is something of alarm, they immediately dash into the waters. The big crocodile fed mostly on fish, but also on deer and monkeys that came to drink, perhaps a duck or two. Okay, some change of taste. Always the rotten food, na? So these are the fresh ones. So which are they? Fish, deer and monkeys, poor creatures, they come to drink water without knowing what death is awaiting them. Or the poor duck or two, they come to drink water and it is their last drink, poor creatures. But sometimes here at the ford, he fed on a pie dog, those stray dogs now of the roads, full of parasites or a skeleton cow. And sometimes he went down to the burning huts, another good place to get food. Burning huts, and found half-burned bodies of Indians cast into the stream. So these are also, yes, nice non-veg meal for him. It's non-veg only, it's not a veg creature. Beside him in the shoals as he lay waiting, glimmered a blue gem. Now we come to the title of the story, the blue gem. Actually, gem is a valuable stone. It is not so, but to Sevilla it is. Though it was sand-worn glass that had been rolling about in the river for a long time. By chance, it was perforated. There was a hole right through. The neck of a bottle, perhaps. A blue bead. So, the author herself or the narrator is not aware what it is. Is it a blue bead or is it the neck of a bottle? But there is a perforation in the center. So, it could work as a bead. In the shrill, now the scenario changes. Up till now, the first two pages were about the crocodile, and now we come to our main protagonist, the main positive character is Sevilla. And we come to her, and the scenario changes. In the shrill, noisy village above the ford, out of a mud house, the same color as the ground, came a little girl. A thin, starveling child dressed in an earth-colored rag. She had torn the rag in two to make skirt and sari. So you can understand the poverty-stricken condition in which these people live. Sevilla, she has a rag. She has torn it into two pieces. One is that petticoat, we say. The author calls it a skirt. And on top of it, to put her sari. And as a 12-year-old girl, she is wearing a sari. Sevilla was eating the last of her meal. Just see the last of her meal. You will get another idea about the poverty. Chapati wrapped round a smear of green chili and rancid butter. And she divided this also to make it seem more and beat it, showing straight white teeth. See, at least her complexion and everything is brown, but the teeth is not brown, they are white teeth. And just see her meal. Would you all accept this type of meal? If your parents give you, you will throw it. But for her, she breaks it into pieces so that it seems more. With her ebony hair and great eyes and her skin of oil brown cream, she was a happy, immature child woman. Underline this, happy, immature child woman. You sometimes get a question, why is she a child woman? Age-wise, she is a child. But she has to do all the work that a woman does, right from the time she learned walking. About 12 years old, barefoot of course, and often goosey cold on a winter morning, and born to toil. In all her life, she had never owned anything but a rag. She had never owned even one anna. Just see the poverty. Not a pie. One pie was equal to one paisa, and six pies, that is spice. Six made one anna. So forget anna, she did not have even one paisa. Say a handful of brown glass beads from that stall in the bazaar where there were pile like stars, or one of the thin glass bangles that the man kept on a stick, and you could choose which color he would have. So these are the things which attracts a small girl, the bangles or the necklace and all that, poor girl, but she cannot afford it. She knew what finery was though. She had been with her parents and brothers all through the jungle to the town at the railhead where there was this bazaar. So she has visited the bazaar. She knows about them, the bead, necklace or the bangles. But she cannot afford to buy one for herself, however much she might like them. And she had walked through all the milling people and the dogs and the monkeys full of fleas and the idle, gossiping, bargaining humanity, spitting beetle juice. So while she is passing through the marketplace, she comes in contact with different types of people. Some of them, they are just idly loafing around. Some of them are gossiping. Some of them are bargaining with the shopkeeper. And some of them are spitting beetle juice. Heard the bell of a sacred bull. So a typical market picture through which she had passed many times with her father and brother. She had paused, amazed, and everything attracts her attention. First it was the ornament one, now it is the sweetmeat shop. The sweetmeat stall to gaze at the brilliant honey confections, abuzz with dust and flies. Yeah, nowadays at least they keep it covered with cellophane paper and all that. But that time they were left open for attracting the flies and the dust. They smelled wonderful. The atmosphere was stinking, but the smell of the sweets were wonderful. It surpassed that stinking smell. And what was the stinking smell coming from? The smell of grains and humanity, so much crowd and there's perspiration and the cheap cigarettes. They all made the place stink. But the smell of the sweets was much more sweet smell. It overcame all this nasty smell. At home, she sometimes tasted wild honey or crunched the syrup out of a stalk of sugar cane. But these sweets were green and magenta. They were colorful. Now we come to another one with that attracts her attention. She watches it with great eagerness, but she knows she can't afford. Then there was the cloth stall, stacked with great rolls of new cotton cloth, stamped at the edge with the maker's sign of a tiger's head. And smelling so wonderful of its dressing straight from the mill. So they have come straight from the mill. So a new smell. And Sibia could have stood by it all day going on watching. Such nice colors. And poor girl, she has a rag which she has cut into two. One to make herself a petticoat and then to put a sari. So one rag and two functions. Cut it into two. But there were other wonders to see. Satin sewn with real silver thread, tin trays from Birmingham, and a sari which had got chips of looking glass embroidered into the border. She joined the crowd round the Kashmiri travelling merchant. Yeah, those Kashmiri people, they come to sell shawls and other things on his way to Bangalore. So this person, the Kashmiri merchant, would go from Bangalore to sell his wares. For a few months he would stay, and then after that he would leave for Kashmir. He was showing dawn-colored silks that poured like cream, and he had got a little locked chest. Chest means a box with turquoises and opals in it. These are costly stones. Best of all, a box which when you pressed it, a bell tinkled and a yellow woolen chicken jumped out. So this is a toy. There is a box, you press the bell, then there is a tinkling of a bell and a chicken pops out. There was no end to the wonder. So all these attracted her attention, and why shouldn't it? Because she's just 12 years old. But Sibya, in all her life, from birth to death, was marked for work. This is the tragedy of poverty. So right from her birth till death, she will have to go on laboring, toiling. Just see, since she could toddle, since she could walk, she had learned to walk. That is when first a child learns to walk, we call it a toddler. So from those times, she had husked corn and gathered sticks and put dung to dry and cooked and weeded and carried and fetched water and cut grass for fodder. So much work. She was going with her mother and some other women now. What is she going to do today? To get paper grass from the cliffs above the river. So the women, they go with the other women of the neighborhood, and they take the children also along with them. When you had enough of it, enough of this paper grass, you could take it down by bullock cart to the railhead and sell it to the agent, who would arrange for its dispatch to the paper mills. The woman often toiled all day at this work, and the agent sat on silk cushions smoking a hookah. So they toil, they sell it to the agent gives them some money, they go back home happily. But the real profit makes, the agent makes the real profit. He will sell it at a much higher price. This is poverty. Such thoughts did not trouble Sibya, however, as she skipped along with her sickle and homemade hay fork beside her mother. So she's in a very happy mood. She's skipping and dancing and going. At this moment, it is easy to skip. Why? You'll come to it. You could skip on the way out. Means when you are going to the workplace to cut those paper grass, that time you can skip. And why not in the return journey? But not on the way back, when you ached with tiredness and there was a great load to carry. Yeah, after having cut the grass for the whole day, you are tired. You are in no mood also to skip. Not only that, you carried a heavy load on your back. So it's not possible. Some of the women were wearing necklaces made out of lal beads, the shiny scarlet seeds, black one end, that grew everywhere in the jungle. See, women are so fond of adornment. So what do? If they can't afford to buy from that shop, they make their own things. They take the seeds, different colored seeds, and they perforate it and make necklaces of their own. Self-help. It was best to have new necklaces every year, and every year they could discard and make new ones, instead of last year's faded ones. And Sibya was making one too. Her, how nice it was going to be to hear that rattling swish around her neck as she browsed along with lots of necklaces. But each seed, but it's not such an easy job. Each seed hard as stone, so you have to drill it with a red hot needle. So you put the needle in the fire and make it red hot, and then it is easy to make a hole through the seeds. But what happened? Why was the work not progressing? Because the family needle was snapped, and she must wait till they could buy another. And the poverty is such, we feel, oh, a needle, how much does it cost? But not for them. So she will have to wait till another needle is bought. Oh, the strings. And strings of glass and beads, anklets, earrings, nose rings, bangles, all the gorgeous dazzle of the bazaar. All her little golden body decorated. So she's thinking, oh, if only I could get all of them to decorate my small body. So now they are going towards their workplace to cut the grass. Chattering as they went, the woman followed the dusty track towards the river. On their way, they passed a Gujjar encampment of grass huts, where these nomadic graziers would live for a time until their animals had perhaps finished all the easy grazing within reach, or they were not able to sell enough of their white butter and white milk in the district, or there was no one to buy the young male buffaloes for tiger bait. So nomadic, it's like we say na Banjaras. The Banjaras, they don't make any permanent houses. They live in tents and they stay at a particular place for some time, and after that they change locations. So here, this Gujjar encampment, so they have their cattle, and these they will change places only under these circumstances. Suppose their cattle have, mane those animals, they have finished all the grass of the nearby localities, and another point is they were not able to sell their white milk or white butter, or there was no one to buy their male buffaloes. And fourth point is a cattle killing tiger was making a nuisance of their animals, nuisance of himself by killing their animals, picking them away and going. So when these four points were there, they would leave this venue and go for a different one. Then they moved on. Sibiya glanced at the Gujjar woman as she went past. They wore trousers. See, actually, it's not the trouser we say. Norah Burke is a foreigner, so for a legwear, she calls it a trouser. It could be a churidar because just see, wrinkled at the ankles. Churidar or a salwar, something like that. It's typically Indian. Trousers are not Indian, especially a Gujjar woman to wear trousers. I don't think so. And in their ears, large silver rings made out of melted rupees. And one of them was clinking a stick against the big brass ghada, actually. Don't pronounce it gurras, Gurra, she has written. Actually, it would have been better if she had put the English equivalent of this. This is an Indian word, it's ghada. And it is written gurra. You must be wondering what is this. Big brass ghada in which they fetched water. This is the clue. So rather, after this, in bracket, she could have put pitcher. That would have been helpful. From the river for the camp to see which ones were empty. And the men and boys were out of camp just now with a herd, or with a herd of their buffaloes and all that, or gone to the bazaar to sell produce. So either taking their animals to graze or going to the market to sell their product of milk and butter. But one or two buffaloes were standing about, creatures of great wet noses, moving jaws, and gaunt black bones. The Gujjars were junglis, uncivilized, as Sibiya was too, born and bred in the forest. Yes, born and brought up in the forest. For countless centuries, their forebears, that means their forefathers, had lived like this, getting their living from animals, from grass and trees. So animals, grass and trees, they depended upon these three things. So they scratched their food together and stored their substance in large herds and silver jewelry. They were man in the wandering pastoral age, not stone age. In stone age, you must have read in history, what did they do with the help of the stones? They killed animals and then they had them for their food. They hunted. Stone age men hunted. They are not hunters. And not yet cultivators, so they haven't started cultivating grains and all that. So these were of the pastoral age, though it is not the pastoral age now, but they lived their lives as people lived in the pastoral age. How? Which are the things they depended? They depended on trees, animals, and grass. Now there was the river twinkling between the trees, sunlit beyond dark trunks, the dark trunks of trees beyond it. They could hear it rushing along. The women came out on the shore and made for the stepping stones. The stepping stones, they would go from one stone to the other, and in this way they would go to the other side. They had plenty to laugh and bicker about. Yes, they were laughing, they were talking loudly, they were fighting. As they approach the river in a noisy crowd. Who are these? Sibiya, her mother, and their neighbors. They girded up their skirts. Yes, they pulled their skirts, girding it, so as to jump from stone to stone, and they clanked their sickles and forks. These are the things with which they will cut the grass. Together over their shoulders. Yeah, they put it on their shoulders, their instruments, and then it makes easy movement. They shouted their quarrels above the gush of the river. Quarrel and bickering, they are synonymous. Noise frightens crocodiles. The big mugger did not move, and all the women crossed in safety to the other bank. Here they have to climb a steep hillside. Just see, the journey is also quite difficult. They cross the river and then they climb a hillside to get at the grass. So from their house to this place is quite far away. But all fell to with a will, but they are not reluctant. They are happy to carry on with their work and sliced away at it wherever there was foothold to be had. Down below them ran the broad river, pouring powerfully out from its deep narrow pools among the cold cliffs and shadows, spreading into warm shallows lit by kingfishers. So the river, what are the things that the river has in its possession? It has the kingfisher, great turtles live there, and mahseer, it's a type of fish, freshwater fish, weighing more than 100 pounds. Crocodiles too. Sometimes you could see them lying on those slabs of clay over there, but there were none to be seen at the moment. Why? Remember, noise frightens crocodiles. So they have now disappeared in hearing the bickering of these women. Where Sibiya was working, wind came across hundreds of miles of trees, cooled her sweating body, and she could look down over the river as if she were a bird. Although she did not dare stop for a moment, why? Her mother, she is doing her work and at the same time keeping eye on her daughter, whether she is doing her work or playing the fool. Under her mother's eyes, her imagination took her in a swooping flight over the bright water and golden air to the banks where she had played as a child.